بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين ولعنة الله على قتلتهم وأعدائهم أجمعين. Welcome to the first episode of the Ali al-Habib show. My name is Ali al-Habib, live to you from the minor land of Fedak. Today's topic, Uthman ibn Affan.
Nothing but good. And haya wal haya kulluhu khair. And all of haya is good. The more haya you have, the better it is. And it is well known that amongst the Sahaba, Uthman ibn Affan was the one who had the most haya. And it is authentically narrated that once the Prophet when it was in his house and he was lying down casually and his shin was exposed. And Abu Bakr came and sat down. Umar came, sat down. And the Prophet did not do anything. When the third knock came, they said, it's Uthman. The Prophet stood up and he covered his shin. So when Uthman left, both Abu Bakr and Umar, they seemed a little bit like, you know, irritated, like, how come you gave him the royal treatment? Say, Ya Rasulullah, when we came, you didn't do that. Why did you do it for Uthman? And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, shouldn't I have haya in front of a man? Even the angels have haya of him.
Of course, it's very important before even moving on to talk about what are the merits of Uthman, just to have this in mind while listening to what's about to happen, or the analysis of what caused these people to even revolt against Uthman in the first place. So the merits of Uthman, we're familiar with a lot of them. The angels are shy from Uthman.
And then the narration mentioned, La ilaha illallah, Uthman goes, he ties his bottom garment tight. You know who Uthman was? One day the Sahaba, when they, the Messenger of Allah, was sitting with Aisha, and Abu Bakr entered, and the Messenger of Allah had a portion of his leg exposed, and he sat how he was. Then Umar entered, he sat how he was. And then there was a knock on the door, and it was Uthman, and the Prophet ﷺ quickly put his garment straight. And after they left, Aisha radiallahu anha said, O Messenger of Allah, my father came, you remained in the position. Umar came. Why did you change your position? Why did you cover your leg when Uthman came? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, shouldn't I have haya? Shouldn't I have shame from the man that even the angels have shame from? He ties his garment.
And this is because he had an exalted character. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described him in the most beautiful of ways. And he said, should I not be shy of a man that the angels are shy of? And this characteristic of shyness is one of the most noble characteristics that a person can possess.
Welcome back. I believe it has become very clear. It has become very clear for the dear viewer how they are extreme in their love for Uthman ibn Affan. Thus, even one of the speakers says that Aisha was in bed with the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, or laying down with the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, while the Prophet, his thigh was uncovered, and the Prophet, peace be upon him, lets Abu Bakr enters upon him, and he sees him in this way, and so does Umar. But when Uthman comes, they say that the Prophet, peace be upon him, covered himself. They are willing to asperse and insult the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, only to lift the high, extreme love of Uthman ibn Affan. Lift the status of Uthman ibn Affan in the people's eyes. But it's really amusing, to be honest with you, when they say that Uthman, that the angels are shy of Uthman. It's like they are not aware of what their scholars say. It's like they are not aware of what the biggest of the tabi'een say. The tabi'een, one of the tabi'een is a man who the people used to go to while the companions were present. A man called Amir al-Sha'bi. Amir al-Sha'bi is one of the Tabi'een who said that Uthman was an agitated insulter. كان عثمان غضبا سبابا. And they say his modesty, his shyness, his mannerisms. Tell me, where are the mannerisms that they speak of في أرض الواقع, in the hadith, in the narrations? Where are his manners? Where are his so-called shyness? For example, I bring to you first the statement of Amir al-Sha'bi. And Amir al-Sha'bi, in order for you to know what is this man, and who is this man, and how he is very highly regarded in the so-called Sunni sect, I will read to you what do their scholars say about him. Everyone knows al-Dhahabi. Al-Dhahabi, in Siyar I'lam al-Nubala, volume 4, he said, عامر بن شراحيل ابن عبد ذي كبر, the Imam, the scholar of his time. This is very important. It's very important that I mention these things. It's very important that I mention who is Amir al-Sha'bi and how weighty is his statement, how weighty it is. The scholar of his time, Abu Amr al-Hamadani thumma al-Sha'bi. And then al-Dhahabi narrates the what the scholars have said about him. From Abi Mijlaz, who said, I have never seen a man more jurisprudential than al-Sha'bi, more jurisprudential than al-Sha'bi. Not Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, nor Tawus, nor Ata, nor Hassan, al-Hassan al-Basri, nor Ibn Sirin, and I have seen all. And I have seen all. Another one from Abi Bakr al-Hudhari, who said that Ibn Sirin had told him, Ibn Sirin, who is another Tabi'i, one of the biggest of the Tabi'in, who had told him, hold on to al-Sha'bi, for I have seen him being asked about the religion while the companions of the Messenger of Allah are present. The people used to leave the companions who accompanied the prophets, peace be upon him and his progeny, and they used to go to al-Sha'bi. Now, what does al-Sha'bi say? What does al-Sha'bi say about Uthman ibn Affan? Did al-Sha'bi know of a narration that states that the Prophet, peace be upon him, said that Uthman ibn Affan, the angels are shy of Uthman ibn Affan? Did he know of this narration? And if he knew of this narration, then why is he contradicting the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? How can he contradict the statements of the prophets when the prophet says that the angels are shy of Uthman because of his manners, because of his modesty, because of his akhlaq? Yet, he says, on the other hand, كان عثمان غضبا سبابا. Uthman was an agitated insulter. When he gets agitated, when he gets frustrated, he insults. And he insults, not the insults that may come to your mind, no. Insults with the vilest of terms and the most filthiest of terms. I bring you a narration that is in Tariq al-Madina ibn Shabba, Umar ibn Shabba, volume 3, and this is one of the early works in Islamic history and the most relied upon with regards to Uthman ibn Affan, as some of the speakers in this in the videos shown have said. He said, from al-Sha'bi, our man, who said, Abu Abdullah al-Jadali was a slave to the tribe of Azd, until he says, it's a long narration, that does not matter to us, until he says, until came the time of Uthman ibn Affan. Until came the rule of Uthman ibn Affan. At the end of his rule, where he gathered the people and said, whoever was oppressed by me shall stand. Uthman ibn Affan, towards the end of his rule, he tried to play the miskeen card, the victim card. He has been oppressing the people for 12 years. Or if you want me to be direct and exact, in order for me to give the hujjah for the so-called Sunni sect, the last 6 years of Uthman ibn Affan was an absolute misery for the people. The people were oppressed. The people did not have food to eat because of Uthman's prosperity, giving his aqarib, his relatives, thousands upon thousands upon hundreds of thousands of dirhams, and leaving the people hungry. So he wanted to mend things when the people started to march, when the people marched from Mecca or from Basra, Hukaym ibn Jabalat al-Abdi with 300 men, warriors, marched towards Medina. Al-Ashtar al-Nakhi, Malik al-Ashtar, who Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, says, كان لي كما كنت لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله. Malik was to me as I was to the Messenger of Allah. Ponder upon this. Malik was to Amir al-Mu'mineen as Ali was to the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وآله. How did Ali alayhi salam defend the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him? How was he his right command, his right hand in command? Malik was like this to Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. These are the likes of people who rebelled against Uthman. Of course, there are individuals that we absolutely disregard and we disassociate from them. Those who had matami' dunyawiyya, worldly, let's say, worldly desires, worldly desires, who rebelled against Uthman. No, I'm speaking about those who rebelled upon Uthman with the intention that this man's a tyrant, this man is an oppressor, this man cannot hold the khilafah of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. He's not worthy of wearing the rope of the khilafah. These are the people I'm speaking about. Kumail bin Ziyad al-Nakhi and the others, when they marched against Uthman and they cornered him and they sieged him, he tried to mend things. He tried to play the victim card. I'm an old man, I recite the Quran. And this is what the people do. This is a game that the politicians play. This is a game that politicians play. When they are in the absolute power of their rule, in their golden age, let's say, they are fara'ina, tyrants. They oppress people. They disturb the lives of the people. They cut the means of the people, their daily bread, as we will see with Abu Abdullah al-Jadali, who is not a Shi'i. He is a mutashayya. He became a Shi'i later on, and we will know why. These are what they do. If we look at Saddam Hussein, for example, does anyone disagree with me that Saddam Hussein was a tyrant? Saddam Hussein, the Fir'aun of his time, the tyrant of his time. When he was captured and found in a hole in the ground, what's happened to him? He grew a beard and he got the Quran in courts, reciting the Quran as if the malaika came on him. This 180 degrees turn. Yesterday you were drinking khamar. Yesterday you were drinking wine and with partying and telling me, what do we have with deen? What do we have with religion? When he gets in court, oh, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. Uthman's of the same type. Uthman's of the same category. A political game that the politicians play against the people. And the people, they believe, unfortunately. So Uthman gathered the people in the masjid and said, whoever was oppressed by me shall stand. Uthman saying, whoever is oppressed by me shall stand, is saying that I have oppressed people. Whoever who was oppressed by me shall stand. Abu Abdullah al-Jadali, our man, the man who the narration speaks about. Abu Abdullah al-Jadali stood up and said, O Uthman, you have confined my food the way a pigeon confines its meal in its crop. Meaning, that you have cut my daily bread and means of living. Uthman retorted, what are you in this, you motherless slave of ruins? What are you in this, you motherless slave of ruins? Did your tribe not come to me claiming that you are a slave? So I said, I see the skin of an Arab, and granted you 2,000, and married you to an Arab woman from your tribe, and you did not take into account, nor did you thank. Get out, O motherless. Abu Abdullah al-Jadali stood up, saying to Uthman that you have cut my daily means of living. Uthman retorts, do you not remember what I helped you with? Do you not remember what I how I gave you 2,000 and Arab you to, and married you to an Arab woman, and I said that I see a skin of an Arab. I don't see that you are a slave. When their tribe came to him and said that he's from us, ila akhiri, this does not matter to us. But what matters to us is this. Is this statement. After al-Sha'bi narrates this narration to us, after he says, Uthman said, get out, O motherless. O motherless, this is a big shatima in the Arabs, for the Arabs. This is a big shatima, it's a big insult to the Arabs. Amir al-Sha'bi says, وَكَانَ عُثْمَانُ غَضِبًا سَبَّابًا. Uthman was an agitated insulter. When he gets agitated, when he gets frustrated, he insults. He insults. He's supposed to mend things over here in the masjid. He's supposed to try to calm things down. He's making the persona, he's giving the persona that he has become merciful. Whoever who is oppressed by me shall stand. But when he gets agitated, a man stood up, Abu Abdullah al-Jadri, saying that you've cut my means of living. Uthman responds with what? Get out. What are you in this, you motherless slave of ruins? I brought this narration only to get this statement from Amir al-Sha'bi. This is not what Uthman says. This is nothing to Uthman ibn Affan. This is absolutely nothing. His vocabulary in insults and filthy terms is very big and wide, as we will see, inshallah. So I've only bought this narration to get this shahada, this witness from Amir al-Sha'bi, that Uthman was an agitated insulter. Now we bring a mithal. Again from Tariqh al-Madinati ibn Shabba, volume 3, page 133. And this is a sahih narration. It is sahih. لا غبار عليه. Narrated to us from Musa ibn Ismail, trustworthy, that Yusuf ibn al-Majishun, trustworthy. Narrated from Salih ibn Ibrahim ibn Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, the grandson of Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, the so-called Sahabi, trustworthy. From his father, Ibrahim, trustworthy. From Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, the son of Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, is now narrating to us what's happened to his father, Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf. Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, to them, to the so-called Sunni sect, he is from the Asharat al-Mubashara, the ten people that were promised paradise. And to us, he is from the biggest of the hypocrites. From the biggest of the hypocrites. أكبر المنافقين من أكابر المنافقين. He was amongst those who marched to Fatima's house, صلوات الله عليها, with fires and swords and spears to attack the house and take Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali عليه السلام to Abu Bakr. He is amongst those who attacked the house of Fatima, صلوات الله عليها. The son of Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf said, whilst we were sitting with Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf in his home, whilst we were sitting with my father, Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, in his home, a man entered upon Abd al-Rahman and said, after greeting him, after saying salam, and Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf responds to his salam, to his greeting. He says, come over here, come over here, I need to speak to you. We all know who this man is. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf got up and went to him between the door and the curtain. They went and had some privacy, yani, because that man had to had some things to say to Uthman, to Abdul Rahman ibn Auf. So he went behind between the door and the curtain. Then, time went by. Some time went by. Minutes went by. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf went to this man and went behind the door and the curtain. Time went by, some minutes went by. Then he says, then he entered, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, then he entered upon us with an infuriated, pouting face. His face was full of blood. His face was puffed and full of blood. Has anyone seen the angry face emoji? This was the face of Abdul Rahman ibn Auf when he came back. He entered upon us with an infuriated, pouting face. His face was puffed and full of blood. So I said to him, he said to his father, you came with a face different from the face you entered with. You went with this man behind the door and the curtain with a face, with your normal face, and you came back with a different face. Your face became like a tomato. Zain, different than the face you entered with. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf retorted, listen to this. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf retorted, yes, that was the messenger of Uthman. He called upon me, cursed me immensely, then left. He called upon me, cursed me immensely, then left. Uthman does not only swear and insult face to face and he says the words. No, he sends rasuls, he sends messengers. He says, he goes, this is your job, O messenger. You go to Abdul Rahman ibn Auf and you read out the letter of Uthman ibn Affan. Curse be upon you, curse be upon you. I'm not going to read the, I'm not going to say any words that are not suitable. And then, well, you can understand what I mean. You can understand what I mean. Uthman would send a messenger to Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, one of the 10 promised paradise, according to you. Reads out a letter full of insults that he came with an infuriated, pouting face. His face became like a tomato. His face became like the angry face emoji that we see. His face was puffed and full of blood. And he retorted, yes, that was the messenger of Uthman. He called upon me, cursed me immensely in my house, cursed me immensely, then left. Does not care. I say the message of Uthman ibn Affan, and I, the first, the second, the fourth hundred maybe curse words, then I leave. But we don't know what exactly is said over here. We don't know exactly what was the statement of Uthman. But I will. It's a research. We will get to what Uthman says. What's filthy? How filthy is his tongue? How filthy is his tongue? And his filthy tongue and insults didn't just stop there. It didn't just stop at saying Suriha alayka ba'dahuma to Amr ibn al-As, as it is reported in Tariq al-Madina. It's a narration that I was not able to translate, unfortunately, due to shortage of time. But briefly, I will mention it, is that Uthman ibn Affan was in a sitting with Muawiyah, and Amr ibn al-As entered upon them. And Muawiyah was kind of, Uthman ibn Affan was showing off that how much karam, and how much I am kind to the people, or how much I'm generous to the people. I have closed the door of kindness and generosity on you, O Muawiyah, meaning that I have passed you in generosity. So Amr ibn al-As started to speak to Uthman ibn Affan, and then he said that you are not more generous than the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, and his progeny. And then he speaks, etc. And then Uthman replies to to Amr ibn al-As, the narration does not, my memory does not serve me. And then he says, Uthman ibn Affan to Amr ibn al-As, صُلِحَ عَلَيْكَ بَعْدَهُمَا. When he says, when Amr ibn al-As says, I am the son of the Atikatain. I am the son of the Atikatain. Uthman, you know what he says? صُلِحَ عَلَيْكَ بَعْدَهُمَا. Defecation is upon you after them. Defecation. This is one of the insults of Uthman ibn Affan. Walakin, this is not my research today. My research today is to prove that the insults of Uthman ibn Affan and his filthy tongue did not stop at cursing the companions, the other companions, or so-called companions, Amr ibn al-As, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Ammar ibn Yasir. No, he went as far as to curse the commander of the faithfuls, Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam. I bring to you Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal al-Shaybani. Subhan, please open the camera. Let's put the laptop aside. This is a narration that I have brought forward to you, before you. This is a narration that also proves the distortion of Ahmad ibn Hanbal, or his son Abdullah, or the narrator of this book, Abu Bakr al-Qati'i. This shows the distortion, how they wanted to hide what was said to Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam. I read to you the narration, inshallah. Narration numbered 424. It was narrated that Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab said, Uthman went for Hajj, and when he was halfway there, Ali was informed that Uthman had told his companions not to do tamattu', meaning tamattu', as in tamattu' bil umrati wal hajj, or hajj tamattu', as it is known. Ali said to his companions, when he sets out, set out too. Did you ponder upon the narration? Ali said to his companions, I would like to take maybe a few minutes here just to tackle this. For those batteriya, for those khawana, for those who label themselves as Shia and say that that Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam did not oppose Abu Bakr and Umar, did not oppose Uthman ibn Affan, did not oppose him, he was good with them, and etc. They were mistaken in taking the rights of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam, but Ali alayhi salam did not oppose them. Is that not a clear opposition to Uthman ibn Affan? Is that not clear when he says Ali was informed that Uthman told his companions not to do tamattu'? Ali said to his companions, who are his companions? Who are the companions of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam? His Shia. To those who say that there was no Shia at the time of the Prophet, there was no Shia at the time of Uthman ibn Affan, nor the time of Abu Bakr, nor the time of Umar. Shias were a later creation by the creation of Abdullah ibn Saba. These ignorant individuals who say that the Shias were created when Amir al-Mu'mineen fought Muawiyah, when Amir al-Mu'mineen fought Muawiyah in the Battle of Siffin, there were then Shi'atu Aliyin wa Shi'atu Muawiyah. There was no Shi'as at the time of the Prophet, nor were there Shi'as at the time of the so-called Khulafa. What is this? Tell me, what is this? Ali was informed that Uthman told his companions not to do tamattu'. Ali said to his companions, when he sets out, set out too. These companions that are willing to obey the commander of the faithfuls, even in disobeying the tyrants of their time, the so-called Khalifa. These companions that are willing to oppose, he's opposingly, yani openly directing, opposing Uthman ibn Affan. Directly opposing Uthman ibn Affan in his verdict, when he disallows the enjoyments of Umrah and Hajj, or Hajj al-Tamattu. These are the companions that are willing to do anything for Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam. Mu'minuna bi wilayatihi. They believe in his authority and his commandship. When he sets out to clear rejection, clear opposition to Uthman ibn Affan and his verdict. When Uthman sets out, I want to disobey him. I want to show him his weakness. He teaches him his place, Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam. When he set out to Ali and his companions entered Ihram for Umrah and Hajj. Bil Umrati wal Hajj. Where is it in the Arabic? فأهل علي وصحبه بالعمرة. Ali started to do talbiyah. He said, لبيك بعمرة وحجة. لبيك بعمرة وحجة. He entered Ihram for both Umrah and Hajjah. Clear opposition, like I said, clear opposition to Uthman ibn Affan and his verdict and his rule, and clear, humiliating Uthman ibn Affan. Uthman says, I disallow this. This is not allowed. Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam enters to Ihram with both Hajj and Umrah. Zain. When he sets out to Ali and his companions entered Ihram for Umrah, and Uthman did not say anything to them. How was he able to say anything to him? Anyway, according to this narration, although we all know what he actually said, but according to this narration, he did not oppose Amir al-Mu'mineen. How can he oppose Amir al-Mu'mineen according to this narration while his companions are behind him? Miqdad ibn al-Aswad, Abu Dharr, Salman, Khalid ibn Sa'id ibn al-As, a companion from Banu Umayyah, one of the companions who opposed Abu Bakr while he was on the minbar, calling for the wilaya of Ali alayhi salam, calling for the commandship for the imam of Ali, Khalid ibn Sa'id ibn al-As, a name that no one knows, not the Shia, nor the so-called Sunnah. He's a forgotten companion. Why? Because he's the companion of Ali, Abu Tufail, and the likes of them. We have calls, I know, inshallah. As soon as I finish the narration, inshallah, I'll take the calls, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Uthman did not say anything to them. Ali then said, Have I not been told that you have forbidden tamattu'? Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam goes to Uthman ibn Affan and says, Have I not been told that you have forbidden tamattu? He's absolutely degrading Uthman ibn Affan. Have I not been told that you have forbidden tamattu? Didn't the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi do tamattu? The narrator said, I don't know what answer Uthman gave. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. He says, I don't know what answer Uthman gave, although we will know what answer Uthman gave. What did he say to Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam as we go through Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal? I'd like to take a call here, because I really apologize that there's been five or six calls waiting. Inshallah, I'll take the first caller, Ilyas from Algeria. Welcome there, brother Ilyas.
Welcome, thank you so much. How are you? Assalamu alaikum. How are you, brother?
Alhamdulillah, how are you there, brother?
I'm very fine, thank you so much. How about you, brother?
Alhamdulillah, nahmadullah wa nashkura. Welcome.
Alhamdulillah, thank you so much.
Welcome.
Well, brother, yes, I have only one question, which is, why it's so hard for Bakriya to recognize the corruption that Uthman has caused to this nation and to this religion, to this holy religion. And even though, like, there is a clear opposition of Amir al-Mu'mineen and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa
sallam.
I mean, why it's so hard? Yeah, why it's so hard for these people, Bakriya, to let's say, to hate this person who has caused such corruption and whose corruption is so obvious.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa ala qulubin aqfaluha. And on the hearts there are keys. Or locks, sorry.
Yeah.
And on the hearts there are locks. Wa ala qulubin aqfaluha. The evidence is very clear. The evidence is so clear. Uthman, how can they respect Uthman ibn Affan? How can they respect him? How can, when it's in their books, as we see, I'm picking up Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal here. And from Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal, we would know what's Amir al-Mu'mineen, what Uthman said to Amir al-Mu'mineen, the commander of the faithfuls. What's the crimes that he done, how he oppressed the Ummah, how he gave Marwan ibn al-Hakam this amount of money and attacked Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and attacked Ammar ibn Yasir. Uthman's crimes have, yani, are overloaded. There is
yes,
an overwhelming evidence that Uthman cannot be respected. Yet, their cognitive dissonance, yani, makes them disagree with anything. This is a hadith. This is a sahih hadith. This is from your books. No. Don't tell me. Uthman ibn Affan is good, and that's it. This is the mentality that they have grown with. Although, inshallah, yani, with these episodes or with these shows and with the works of the brothers at Rafidah, wallah, we aim, inshallah, to guide these people, to let them see that Uthman is not to be respected, Abu Bakr is not to be respected, Umar is not to be respected. If we break those idols, as soon as we break those idols, we will be open to, we will, inshallah, cause them to be guided. If their idols stay, as in, Uthman is a good person. Uthman, no, he's the Nurayn, tastahi minhu al-Malaika, he's a good person. No. If these stay, they would never be able to be guided. They will never be able to take the aqidah of the Shia. Even if they say that Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam is the rightful successor. There are people who say, no, Amir al-Mu'mineen is the rightful successor from the Bakriya, from the so-called Ahlul Sunnah. They say, no, Amir al-Mu'mineen is the rightful successor, is the Prophet, peace be upon him, clearly commanded us to follow him, appointed him as his successor and the Khalifa of the Mawla of this Ummah. But Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman, they are good people. If we don't break those idols, they would never become guided. They would never become guided. There are many examples of this. There's Zaydiya and parts of the sects from the so-called Sunni sects. So inshallah, we attempt and we try our best to expose Uthman ibn Affan and what his innovations and his crimes, inshallah. Is Brother Ilyas still with me? Looks like that the call has been disconnected. Inshallah, we continue with the research. Inshallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Salawatullahi wa salam alayka Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. According to this narration, we see that the narrator says, I don't know what answer Uthman gave. I don't know what answer Uthman gave. So we go, inshallah, to the second narration that will explain to us bit by bit. Narration 431. It was narrated that Qatada said, I heard Abdullah ibn Shaqiq say, Uthman forbade tamattu, or forbade tamattu, and Ali enjoined it. وَعَلِيٌّ يُلَبِّي بِهَا عَلِيٌّ يُلَبِّي بِهَا Uthman forbids it. Ali says, لَبَّيْكِ بِعُمْرَةٍ وَحَجَّةٍ Clear disassociation or clear opposition, clear rejection, and clear degrading Uthman and his verdict and his rule and what he comes with. he forbids or he permits. And Ali enjoined it. Uthman said to Ali, Uthman said something to Ali. Again, we don't know what Uthman said to Ali. What does it say? فَقَالَ لَهُ عُثْمَانُ قَوْلًا. Uthman said something to Ali. We have another call. Inshallah, we'll respond to it or we'll take it, inshallah, bin Allah ta'ala, Muhammad from Bradford. Inshallah, we'll take it as soon as we finish this narration. Uthman said something to Ali. Something, make sure there's a line underneath it. Keep it in your mind. And Ali said to him, you know that the Messenger of Allah did that? Uthman said, yes, but we were in a state of fear at that time. Shu'bah said to Qatada, what were they afraid of? He said, I don't know. No one knows what Uthman is hallucinating. What's fear? There was no fear at that time. It was after Fath Mecca. After the Fath of Mecca. What are you afraid of? The part that we want to show here is that Uthman said something to Ali. Uthman said something to Ali. What is this something? Inshallah, we will continue the research after we take Muhammad from Bradford. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, Dibuda Ali and Habib. First, I would like to say that I put so much work into your show. It's really beneficial. I'm going to keep it nice and short, Ali al-Habib. Basically, I was reading into the seerah of Imam Jafar Sadiq alayhi salam. And we know he's the teacher of Abu Hanifa.
Sahih.
I was just wondering why Abu Hanifa was not a Shia of Imam Jafar Sadiq alayhi salam, even though he was taught by a great Imam. Sorry if it's off topic. That's just the question that's been bothering me for a bit. And we'd really appreciate if you want to touch on it.
Abu Hanifa, though he was a student of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, but he only was a student of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam only to get the knowledge that Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam has. He is the house of, he is from the house of knowledge, Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Of course, the biggest of their scholars would go to Imam al-Sadiq salawatullahi alayhi and seek knowledge. Of course, yes. this is known, but Abu Hanifa, there's a whole research that Sheikh al-Habib has bought the recent weeks that Sheikh has been doing researches. He has basically proven that Abu Hanifa used to stab Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam in the back, insult him in the back, but in front of him he's like a rat who hides his tail. Okay. He seeks knowledge from him.
Yeah.
Then he goes and stabs him in the back.
Yeah. Sure.
But inshallah, we'll discuss that later on. Abu Hanifa is amongst those who were the students of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. However, he only was a student to him only because he needs the knowledge required. He needs the knowledge required. Otherwise, if it was not that, he would not have went there. But because Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam comes from the household of knowledge, the household of light, he is forced. There is no any other way. There's no any other sheikh that I can go to get the knowledge that Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam has. Why? Because they know that Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he is from the nur, from the light of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi.
Yeah.
Inshallah, this answers your question.
Thank you very much for that.
Barakallahu fikum. Inshallah, we continue with the research. As we have said, that the narrations are not clear as to what did Uthman say to Amir al-Mu'mineen. I don't know, the Rawi says, Uthman said something to Ali, and Ali said to him, you know that the Messenger of Allah did that. Ila akhir al-riwayah, ila akhir al-hadith, narration. We go to the second hadith. Or the third hadith, I should say, numbered 432. It was narrated that Qatada said, Abdullah ibn Shaqiq said, Uthman used to forbid mut'at al-hajj, and Ali used to enjoin it. In the Arabic, what does it say? وَعَلِيٌّ يَأْمُرُ بِهَا. Ali alayhi salam orders it. Ali alayhi salam orders it. Uthman forbids it. Ali orders it. Ali orders it. Is that not a rejection to Uthman ibn Affan and his verdict? Is that not an insult to Uthman and his rule? Let the Batriya wake up. And let the so-called Ahlul Sunnah wake up. Let them know that it was not sweetened bread with Uthman ibn Affan. Aslan Uthman ibn Affan, according to these narrations, he says to Amir al-Mu'min, إِنَّكَ لَكَثِيرُ الْخِلَافِ عَلَيْنَا خَبَّثْتَ عَلَيْنَا. You always oppose us. You always oppose us. خَبَّثْتَ عَلَيْنَا. خَبَّثْتَ. خَبَّثْتَ. Saying that you have, يعني, I don't know how to exactly translate it, but saying that you have خَبَّثْتَ عَلَيْنَا. يعني try to use your wickedness against us. Uthman says to Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali alayhi salam, yes, إِنَّكَ لَكَثِيرُ الْخِلَافِ عَلَيْنَا. You always oppose us. خَبَّثْتَ عَلَيْنَا. You use your wickedness against us. So it was not bread and sweets between Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam and Uthman as these individuals try to portray. We continue, inshallah. وَعَلِيٌّ يَأْمُرُ بِهَا. And Ali used to order it. Uthman said, again, can you see? I'm not sure if they can see. Subhan, if the book is not clear, please let me know. It says, and Ali used to enjoin it. Uthman said, again, something to Ali. Then Ali said, you know that we did tamattu' with the Messenger of Allah. He said, yes, but we were in a state of fear then. Look here. Sorry. Yes, but we were in a state of fear then. Of course, this is a challenge to the Mukhalifin, Ahlul Khilaf, to explain to us what was the fear of Uthman. Why does no one know what was Uthman is talking about? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Salaamu Allahi alayka Aba Abdullah al-Husayn wa la'natullahi ala qatalatika wa a'da'ik. No one knows what Uthman is hallucinating over here. As even one of the yani people who were present at the time, Qatada, he says, what were they afraid of? He says, I don't know. We go, inshallah, to the third narration. The third narration. I believe we have a caller from New Jersey, Hamid. Hamid, assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum, brother Hamid. Brother Hamid, are you with us? Assalamu alaikum. Okay, inshallah, we continue with the research. Over here, we want to know what was the statement of Uthman ibn Affan to Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam. What was the insult that he puts out to Amir al-Mu'mineen, the commander of the faithfuls, Ali alayhi salam? Hadith 733. It was narrated that Marwan ibn al-Hakam, the Nasibi, the one who used to curse Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam. The one who used to curse Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam and insult him and curse the Ahlul Bayt, all of them, Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. Marwan ibn al-Hakam said, we were walking with Uthman and we saw a man entering Ihram for both Umrah and Hajj. Uthman said, who is this? They said, Ali. He said, do you not know that I have forbidden this? He said to Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam, do you not know that I have forbidden this? He said, yes, but I will not give up the advice of the Messenger of Allah for your opinion. I will not let you bury the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, for your opinion. Your opinion means nothing to me. Aftatu anz. I would not leave the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah for your opinion. We have another caller. I believe Hamid is back. Hamid from New Jersey. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. How are you, Sheikh Ali?
Alhamdulillah. I am not a sheikh. I am your brother.
Habibi, I missed you.
Barakallahu feekum. Me too.
Ya Allah. Habibi, I know you're going in a very methodological... Ya Allah, I can't speak today. Sorry. You're going in a very methodological order. You're speaking in a timeline, let's say. Now, please forgive me. I want to, let's say, jump the timeline. Yep. I believe, in my opinion, the biggest proof for us against Uthman is what it is that.
Subhan, if you can clear the voice and raise the volume of the speaker, of the caller. Yes, brother.
Did you hear what I said?
Yes, I can hear it, but it's just very low. I can hear. Go ahead.
Okay. I believe the best proof for us, for our case against Uthman, obviously his death and his burial, and his how they buried him, where they buried him. Was he buried with the Muslims? If he was, he wasn't. But yeah, I mean, these details.
Brother Subhan, can you please clear up the voice or raise it? I cannot hear the caller very well, unfortunately. And there's an echo in my. I can hear an echo of my voice, which is hiding the voice of the caller. If you can raise your voice or your volume, brother Hamid.
Inshallah, is it better now?
Tafadhal, dear brother.
Is it better now, inshallah?
Inshallah.
Yani, if you can just shed some light regarding Uthman's death, mm-hmm. and then following the instance that followed his death, yani, his burial, where he was buried. Sahih. How come he wasn't buried with the Muslims? I know you're going in, and I forgive you. I ask for you to forgive me for.
Oh, of course.
And this is probably something you were going to present in the future, but this is something very important now.
Sahih.
That came to my mind.
Sahih.
This is because you know why? You know what is, Brother Ali? Hmm. If we want to know what someone thinks about us, شخصياً, right? You don't look about what he's saying to us. Why? Because most people are like rats, right? They're two-faced. You see what I mean? Unfortunately, this is how it is. So if you want to know what someone really thinks about you, you have to hear it from someone else. Oh, when you're not there, this is what he says, right? When Uthman dies, what did the Sahaba do? What did the great, as they call it, what did the great Sahaba, what happened with them? What was their fate? How did they treat Uthman?
According to the Sahih reports, according to the narrations in Tariq al-Tabari and the likes, of these historical books, Uthman ibn Affan, after he was killed, and he was killed by whom? By the companions.
The Sahaba themselves.
By the companions. The companions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with. May Allah be pleased with Uthman ibn Affan, and also may Allah be pleased with his killer. This is the mentality of the so-called Sunni sect. For example, Amr ibn al-Hamiq al-Khuza'i, according to our narrations, he's the one who killed Uthman. According to the narrations, that is sahih. Amr ibn al-Hamiq al-Khuza'i was one of the companions of Badr. One of the companions of Badr that were present in Badr. He's the one who killed Uthman and said, I have stabbed Uthman nine times.
MashaAllah.
Three of them are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And six of them are for what hatred I have for him in my heart.
La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah.
The man, Amr ibn al-Hamiq al-Khuza'i, he is known. He is very well known. He is from the Badriyin, those who were present with the Messenger of Allah in the Battle of Badr. And the warriors that entered upon Uthman ibn Affan, not all of them. Again, I mentioned that we don't praise all the killers of Uthman ibn Affan. We praise those who killed Uthman ibn Affan and protested against him. Siege his house, Mabda.
With the right reasons.
Mabda'iyan. Islamic reasons. It is an Islamic protest that was against Uthman ibn Affan. When Amr ibn al-Hamiq al-Khuza'i and Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, the son of Abu Bakr, the son of Abu Bakr ibn Abi Quhafa. And this is the biggest proof that we don't have anything personal with Abu Bakr ibn Abi Quhafa, because we praise his son. Because we praise his son. Our sword or our miqyas, our ruler is Amir al-Mu'mineen. Whoever who was with Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam and firm upon his promise to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, when he said, Inni tarikum fikum al-thaqalain, I leave behind you two weighty things. Whoever who was firm with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi and firm upon the promise to the Messenger of Allah, we praise him. We praise him. We don't have anything personal with Abu Bakr or Uthman or Umar. And the biggest proof of that is that we praise the son of Muhammad, we praise the son of Abu Bakr, Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, who was amongst 12 men. He was leading 12 men behind him. 12 men behind him. And he went to Uthman ibn Affan. He took him and Uthman ibn Affan was punched up, roughed up a little bit. So he went to Uthman ibn Affan and he dragged him from his bed. Uthman had a long bed. Have you seen Abu Halima's bed? The bed of Abu Halima from the terrorists. Zain? Uthman had a bed like that and it was yellow. It was a yellow bed. Zain? Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr came and he dragged Uthman from his bed, dragging him, like a sheep. Dragging him. If you remember in my third episode of The Carrier of Sins, how I mentioned that Uthman ibn Affan attacked Ammar ibn Yasir and they attacked him in such an animalistic way and then dragged him from the place of where he was attacked to the end of the door or to outside the door. Subhanallah, what goes around comes around, ya akhi. What goes around comes around. As Uthman ibn Affan dragged Ammar ibn Yasir from the room to the door of the house, in this way, in this animalistic way, as we explained in episode 3, he was dragged also, Uthman ibn Affan, by his bed, humiliating him. By who? The son of Abu Bakr, Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. He took Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, drags Uthman ibn Affan to the top from his bed and says, you have ghayyarta kitab Allah. You have changed the book of Allah and you have distorted it. Oh, Na'thal.
The Jew
from Misr with a long beard. Ala yatihal. So Uthman was later killed with this act. Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr pointed to one of the companions, which was Amr ibn al-Hamiq al-Khuza'i, according to our narrations, and he killed Uthman. And Uthman was his body, his blooded body, his disgusting body, you know, a'udhu billah. He was also fat, Uthman. He was fat and he had a long beard and ala yatihal. His body was left for 3 days. 3 days in the trash, next to the rubbish. For 3 days he was left. Where are the companions? The companions, where are the companions? Where are they?
They were the ones
who did this to them. This is why the people of Medina did not support Uthman. It's not logical. How can the people of Medina, how can the Muhajirin and the Ansar not support Uthman ibn Affan or not stand with him? He's been attacked. He's been attacked by the Egyptians, by the Basrans, by the Kufans, by the people of Yemen. What's happening? Where are the Muhajirin? Well, what is happening? This is the Khalifa of the Messenger of Allah, so-called Khalifa. They did nothing. They did nothing. Why? Because they were amongst them. They were amongst them. Uthman was killed. 3 days he was left in the trash, next to the trash, and then they buried him in Hushu Kawkab, the Yahudi cemetery, the Yahudi graveyard, the Yahudi graveyard, the Jewish graveyard.
And
the only people who were present at his janaza were six. His daughter and some other people. So only six people were with the janazah of the Khalifa of the Messenger of Allah, Uthman ibn Affan, the Khalifa. And when they buried him, they buried him quickly also, fearing from the revolters, fearing from the people of Misr and the people of Egypt and the people of Yemen and the people of Kufa and Basra. They were fearful of them to obstruct them, because they were saying that my memory does not serve me either, that he should be left for dogs to eat him or some other thing. I can't remember. But
the vultures. It was the vulture.
So Uthman was buried in Hajj al-Kawkab in the Jewish graveyard. He was not buried with the Muslims.
Yeah.
The Muslims did not allow them. One of the companions of the Messenger of Allah, which we regard highly, maybe his name is Jabala, something Jabala. I forgot his name. He said, if you bury Uthman ibn Affan with the Muslims, I will stop you. I will call the revolters, I'll call the Malik al-Ashtar and the rest of them to stop you. Don't make me, I'm going to allow you to bury him, but bury him with the Jewish. Bury him with the Jews.
Wow.
Don't bury them with the Muslims.
Brother Ali, and inshallah, you know what we have to do now?
Ta'ala, we will discuss this in thoroughly. This is coming, inshallah. This is coming, all in the recent.
Inshallah. Path. Brother Ali, you know what we have to do now?
Ahsant, tell me.
Right now, the name of your show is the al-Habib Show number 1, Uthman, on the finished business. I think the business is now finished. Uthman finished business.
Barakallah.
Inshallah. Let's remove the un from the title. Uthman finished business.
Inshallah. Inshallah. Barakallah.
Inshallah.
May Allah bless you, brother.
Uthman, inshallah.
Barakallah.
Fi amanillah.
We have another caller, it looks like it. Abdul Malik is messaging me, mashallah, a lot of times. I believe that we have another call, but I don't see a name. Farooq from Birmingham. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Tafadhal.
Hello, Brother Ali?
Yes, dear brother. Welcome.
I'm coming from an ex-Sunni background, and I'm Shia now for some years.
No.
So I've seen both sides of this dilemma that we have. And I keep hearing this conversation on a regular basis about Islamic unity, Muslim unity. But we seem to have these innate differences of opinion, which by default seem to be causing us to be disunited. So I'm asking, is there anything that we have or that could be presented which would cause the Muslims to unite around something which would actually create this unity without letting these other things be the diversity tactic to keep us divided? Because this seems to be what's going on. It seems to be like there's two things happening. We need the unity, but we have opinions which are diverting us.
Well, you're saying is correct, dear brother. But the only way to achieve Islamic unity is holding to the rope of Ahlul Bayt, alayhi wasalam. If we both agree that the progeny of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, is what the Messenger of Allah commanded us to follow. Hadith Thaqalin is very clear. We both agree on this. Let's hold on to Ahlul Bayt, alayhim as-salam. Let's see, what do they say in regards to Uthman ibn Affan, for example? What do they say with regards to Abu Bakr and Umar? Let's see, what do they say in regards to Aisha? We follow what they say. And this way is Islamic unity. The Islamic unity is holding on to the Qur'an. Where is the Qur'an? The Qur'an is not, it's a bit far away from me. Holding on to the Qur'an, the book of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Ahlul Bayt. We hold on to them. We see what they said. What did they say when it comes to Uthman ibn Affan? They said, "Ashhadu anna Uthmanu jifatan ala sirat ghadan." Uthman will be a corpse on the sirat tomorrow, meaning the Day of Judgment. Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam says, "Allimu awladakum bughda Uthman." Teach your children the hatred of Uthman. Yes. These are the narrations of the progeny. These are the narrations of Al-Hasan, salawatullahi alayhi, Al-Hasan al-Mujtaba. And the narrations of Imam al-Husayn alike. Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam was on the day of Ashura, on the day of Ashura, as they report, Al-Khawarizmi, as they report, Khawarizmi is not from our scholars, it's from their scholars. He narrates that Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, when the arrow hit his heart, he took out the arrow. And he put his hand on the wound, and it was filled with blood. Then he threw it to the sky. He threw it to the sky, and not a drop came back. Then he went back and filled his hand of the wound of blood, and it became filled with blood. Then he put his hand on his head and on his bed, and he said, "This is how I be. هكذا أكون حتى ألقى الله وجدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وأقول يا جد قتلني أبو بكر وعمر." This is how I be. This is the state that I will be, with my head in blood and my bed is red from the blood. And I go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I speak to my grandfather, O Messenger of Allah, Abu Bakr and Umar have killed me. These are the narrations of the progeny. These are the narrations of Ahlul Bayt. We hold on to them. This is the Islamic unity. I am with Islamic unity, no problem. Let's have Islamic unity with the rope of Ahlul Bayt, on the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt, the progeny. Like this, we achieve Islamic unity. Amma Islamic unity on batil, Islamic unity on batil, this cannot be accepted. You can't tell me Islamic unity, but I will also accept that the killers of Ahlul Bayt will be praised, and we praise Ahlul Bayt. No problem. We praise Ahlul Bayt and we praise the killers of Ahlul Bayt. This is not yani, a football game. Islamic unity is only achieved when we hold on to what the Messenger of Allah said. Like this, we achieve Islamic unity, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Barakallahu feekum.
Okay, my dear.
Barakallahu feekum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Where are we? Do we have another caller?
Yes, we do.
We do. Suhail. Barakallahu feek. Assalamu alaikum, brother Suhail. How much time do I have for the show? Looks like that we would not be able to finish the research today, unfortunately. Assalamu alaikum, brother Suhail.
Yes, brother. Assalamu alaikum.
How are you? Inshallah, you are well.
I'm good. Yes. What about you?
Alhamdulillah. Tafadhal, what is your question?
My question, just a minute. My question is actually about the Uthman, like in Sahih Bukhari, there is a hadith where Prophet is saying that there will be 12 Khalifas and all of them will be from Quraysh.
Sahih.
And Uthman was from the Umayyad dynasty. And then on what basis these so-called Sunnis accept Uthman as a rightly guided Khalifa? Are they not contradicting with their own hadith?
Uthman's from Quraysh.
He was from Umayyad dynasty.
But Umayyad is from Quraysh.
Uthman was not from Quraysh, he was from Umayyad dynasty.
Sahih, Umayyad is Quraysh.
Umayyad,
yeah. Sahih. But when the Prophet, peace be upon him, says, this is according to their narrations, yani, their narrations. And this is one of, actually we take this proof, this narration in Bukhari, to prove the imama of Ali alayhi salam, to prove the imama of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. We can take these narrations and nahujju, yani we mm-hmm. argue with them with these narrations. That's proof. These narrations mm-hmm. at the end, they will be in our benefit. But no, Uthman is from Quraysh. Banu Umayyah are from Quraysh.
Okay, we will use it in our support, like if there is a hadith in Sahih Bukhari, so this is a clear proof that our 12th Imams are the 12th class, sorry, which the Prophet was talking about.
I cannot hear your question.
I mean to say, we can take this hadith in our support, like we say there is a hadith mentioned in Bukhari.
Naam.
That there will be 12 Khalifas after me, and our 12 Imams are the proof of those 12 Khalifas.
I cannot hear your question there, brother. Not very well. Maybe if you call again, inshallah. Maybe if you call again and we'll speak, inshallah.
Can we ask this question, but that was already asked by Brother Hamid, that why the Uthman was not buried in the Muslim cemetery?
I can't understand your question there, brother. I can't understand. Maybe if you call again, inshallah. We'll call again, inshallah. Okay. We'll continue with the narration. And I believe we only have 20 minutes left. It won't be enough to finish the research, unfortunately. But inshallah, we'll continue this research. Although I had a plan, yani, that we, because this the show, inshallah, will be weekly or bi-weekly, depending on yani what's best, inshallah. I was hoping that one episode will be for the Bakriya, the so-called Sunnis, and the next will be for the Shia. But if I'm not able to finish the research today, because I want the people to know, what did Uthman ibn Affan say to Amir al-Mu'mineen? What was the insult that he put out to Amir al-Mu'mineen, the commander of the faithfuls? The people need to know. The people need to know. And only then they will be able to stand, to either stand with Uthman against Amir al-Mu'mineen or stand with Amir al-Mu'mineen against Uthman. It can't be I stand with both. I stand with both the oppressed and the oppressor. It can't be. This is not a game that we should play. You either stand with Amir al-Mu'mineen or you stand with Uthman ibn Affan. According to the Sahih narrations, we're speaking Sahih. This research that I bought is, I made sure that it is Sahih. I made sure that everything that you accept this for it to be Hujjah upon you. Hujjah on the likes of Farid and Yasir Qadi and the people in the video. Uthman, this guy. Zain. Hujjah on the likes of these people. And for the viewers to make a comparison, look at the difference, look at the tarah, look at the research that we bring forward, and look at what they say. The narration that they've quoted, the one that Aisha narrates, is an insult to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. When they say that a man entered upon the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi while his thigh is uncovered, while he's laying with his wife, with Aisha. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi is laying with Aisha. And Umar enters upon them. Umar, who's a non-mahram, upon Aisha. As if you say Abu Bakr entered upon them, he's the father of Aisha. Although would you, if you are married and your father-in-law comes upon you, would you greet him while your thigh is uncovered and you're laying with his daughter? Would you do that? Do you see how they insult our messenger? Do you see how they insult our messenger, the meaning of purity? No, not only Abu Bakr comes, Umar comes in, who is a non-mahram. He sees Aisha laying with the Messenger of Allah while his thigh is uncovered. And Abu Bakr, the Messenger converses with him normally and as if nothing is happening. And then Uthman comes. When Uthman comes, oh, تستحي منه الملائكة, I will hide. I will sit up straight and fix myself. This is our Messenger. This is our Messenger of Allah. This is the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Do you see how it burns you? Wallah, it is a fire in the hearts. It's absolute burn in the hearts. That these are the narrations about our prophets. Why have they fallen into this? Why? Because they have disobeyed the prophet, peace be upon him, and they did not follow the progeny. Anyone who has any type of ghira, any type of zealousness, let's say, if that's the correct translation, any type of manhood would not accept that the Messenger of Allah, who we look at him for manhood, who teaches us manhood, would lay with his wife and men enter upon him while his thigh is uncovered. How can any man accept this? How can any man who is a true Muslim accept this? It looks like that we will not be able to finish the research today. Inshallah, maybe we will take another call and we will finish with this call, inshallah, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, and we will continue the research in the next episode, inshallah. Do we have another caller? We'll leave it there, inshallah. Inshallah, our multaqa, our return, inshallah, is next week, where inshallah we will continue with this research for the people to know what did Uthman ibn Affan say to Amir al-Mu'mineen and how filthy Uthman's tongue is. And is Uthman really, Allah, the angels are shy of Uthman ibn Affan, or the devils are shy of Uthman ibn Affan? The sense of Uthman ibn Affan and the filthiness of Uthman ibn Affan made the devils shy, not the angels. Until then, inshallah, until next week. هذا وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين ولعنة الله على قتلتهم وأعدائهم أجمعين. Thank you.